Avicenna, Persian, c. 980, June 1037, is the Latinate form of Ibn Sina, Arabic, full name Abu Ali al-Husayn ibn Abdallah ibn al-Husayn ibn Ali ibn Sina. He was a Persian polymath regarded both in Europe and the Middle East as one of the most significant thinkers and writers of the Islamic Golden Age. He is known to have written around 450 works across a wide range of subjects, of which around 240 have survived, including 150 on philosophy and 40 on medicine. His most famous works are the Book of Healing, a vast philosophical and scientific encyclopedia, and the Canon of Medicine, an overview of all aspects of medicine that became a standard medical text at many medieval universities and remained in use as late as 1650, as well as philosophy and medicine. Avicenna's corpus also includes writings on astronomy, alchemy, geography and geology, psychology, Islamic theology, logic, mathematics, physics and poetry. Avicenna created an extensive corpus of works during what is commonly known as the Islamic Golden Age, in which the translations of Greco-Roman, Persian, and Indian texts were studied extensively. Greco-Roman, Mid and Neoplatonic, and Aristotelian texts by the Kindi school were commented, redacted and developed substantially by Islamic intellectuals, who also built upon Persian and Indian mathematical systems, astronomy, algebra, trigonometry and medicine. The Samanid dynasty in the eastern part of Persia, Greater Khorasan and Central Asia, as well as the Buyid dynasty in the western part of Persia and Iraq, provided a thriving atmosphere for scholarly and cultural development. Under the Samanids, Bukhara rivaled Baghdad as a cultural capital of the Islamic world. The study of the Quran and the Hadith thrived in such a scholarly atmosphere. Philosophy, fiqh and theology, kalam, were further developed, most noticeably by Avicenna and his opponents. Al-Razi and Al-Farabi had provided methodology and knowledge in medicine and philosophy. Avicenna had access to the great libraries of Bork, Khwarizm, Gorgan, Ray, Isfahan and Hamadan. Various texts, such as the Ard with Bamaniyar, show that he debated philosophical points with the greatest scholars of the time. Aruzi Samarkandi describes how before Avicenna left Khwarizm he had met Rayhan Biruni, a famous scientist and astronomer, Abu Nasr Iraqi, a renowned mathematician, Abu Salmasihi, a respected philosopher, and Abu al-Kaykama, a great physician. Biography. Early life. The only source of information for the first part of Avicenna's life is his autobiography, as written down by his student Juzjani. In the absence of any other sources, it is impossible to be certain how much of the autobiography is accurate. It has been noted that he uses his autobiography to advance his theory of knowledge, that it was possible for an individual to acquire knowledge and understand the Aristotelian philosophical sciences without a teacher, and it has been questioned whether the order of events described was adjusted to fit more closely with the Aristotelian model. In other words, whether Avicenna described himself as studying things in the correct order. However, given the absence of any other evidence, Avicenna's account essentially has to be taken at face value. Avicenna was born c. 980 in Afsna, a village near Bukhara, in present-day Uzbekistan, the capital of the Samanids, a Persian dynasty in Central Asia and Greater Khorasan. His mother, named Sita, was from Bukhara. His father, Abdullah, was a respected Ismaili scholar from Bork, an important town of the Samanid Empire, in what is today Bork Province, Afghanistan. His father was at the time of his son's birth the governor in one of the Samanid New Ibn Mansur's estates. He had his son very carefully educated at Bukhara. Ibn Sina's independent thought was served by an extraordinary intelligence and memory, which allowed him to overtake his teachers at the age of 14. As he said in his autobiography, there was nothing that he had not learned when he reached 18. A number of different theories have been proposed regarding Avicenna's madhab. Medieval historian Zahir al-Din al-Bayhaqi, d. 1169, considered Avicenna to be a follower of the Brethren of Purity. On the other hand, Dimitri Gitters, along with Aisha Khan and Jules J. Janssens, demonstrated that Avicenna was a Sunni Hanafi. However, Shia Fakhanarula Shastari and Syed Hossein Nasr, in addition to Henry Corbin, have maintained that he was most likely a 12 Shia. Similar disagreements exist on the background of Avicenna's family. Whereas some writers considered them Sunni, more recent writers thought they were Shia. According to his autobiography, Avicenna had memorized the entire Quran by the age of 10. He learned Indian arithmetic from an Indian greengrocer, and he began to learn more from a wandering scholar who gained a livelihood by curing the sick and teaching the young. He also studied fiqh, Islamic jurisprudence, under the Hanafi scholar Ismail al-Zahid. As a teenager, he was greatly troubled by the metaphysics of Aristotle, which he could not understand until he read al-Farabi's commentary on the work. For the next year and a half, he studied philosophy, in which he encountered greater obstacles. In such moments of baffled inquiry, he would leave his books, perform the requisite ablutions, then go to the mosque, and continue in prayer till light broke on his difficulties. Deep into the night, he would continue his studies, and even in his dreams problems would pursue him and work out their solution. 40 times, it is said, he read through the metaphysics of Aristotle, till the words were imprinted on his memory, but their meaning was hopelessly obscure, until one day they found illumination from the little commentary by Farabi, which he bought at a bookstall for the small sum of 3 dirhams. So great was his joy at the discovery, made with the help of a work from which he had expected only mystery, that he hastened to return thanks to God, and bestowed alms upon the poor. He turned to medicine at 16, and not only learned medical theory, but also by gratuitous attendance of the sick had, according to his own account, discovered new methods of treatment. The teenager achieved full status as a qualified physician at age 18, and found that medicine is no hard and thorny science, like mathematics and metaphysics, so I soon made great progress. I became an excellent doctor and began to treat patients, using approved remedies. The youthful physician's fame spread quickly, and he treated many patients without asking for payment. Ibn Sina's first appointment was that of physician to the Emir, Newtu, who owed him his recovery from a dangerous illness, 997. Ibn Sina's chief reward for this service was access to the royal library of the Samanids, well-known patrons of scholarship and scholars. When the library was destroyed by fire not long after, the enemies of Ibn Sina accused him of burning it, in order forever to conceal the sources of his knowledge. Meanwhile, he assisted his father in his financial labors, but still found time to write some of his earliest works. When Ibn Sina was 22 years old, he lost his father. The Samanid dynasty came to its end in December 1004. Ibn Sina seems to have declined the offers of Muhammad of Ghazni, and proceeded westwards to Urgench in modern Turkmenistan, where the vizier, regarded as a friend of scholars, gave him a small monthly stipend. The pay was small, however, so Ibn Sina wandered from place to place through the districts of Nishapur and Merv to the borders of Khorasan, seeking an opening for his talents. Qabus, the generous ruler of Tabaristan, himself a poet and a scholar, with whom Ibn Sina had expected to find asylum, was on about that date, 1012, starved to death by his troops who had revolted. Ibn Sina himself was at this time stricken by a severe illness. Finally, at Gorgan, near the Caspian Sea, Ibn Sina met with a friend, who bought a dwelling near his own house in which Ibn Sina lectured on logic and astronomy. Several of Ibn Sina's treatises were written for this patron, and the commencement of his Canon of Medicine also dates from his stay in Hakania. Ibn Sina subsequently settled at Ray, in the vicinity of modern Tehran, the hometown of Razes, where Majd ad-Dawlah, a son of the last Buayid Emir, was nominal ruler under the regency of his mother, Siad Khatun. About 30 of Ibn Sina's shorter works are said to have been composed in Ray. Constant feuds which raged between the regent and her second son, Shams al-Dawlah, however, compelled the scholar to quit the place. After a brief sojourn at Qazvin, he passed southwards to Hamadan, where Shams al-Dawlah, another Buayid Emir, had established himself. At first, Ibn Sina entered into the service of a high-born lady, but the Emir, hearing of his arrival, called him in as medical attendant, and sent him back with presents to his dwelling. Ibn Sina was even raised to the office of vizier. The Emir decreed that he should be banished from the country. Ibn Sina, however, remained hidden for 40 days in Sheikh Ahmed Fadl's house, until a fresh attack of illness induced the emir to restore him to his post. Even during this perturbed time, Ibn Sina persevered with his studies and teaching. Every evening, extracts from his great works, the Canon and the Sanatio, were dictated and explained to his pupils. On the death of the emir, Ibn Sina ceased to be vizier and hid himself in the house of an apothecary, where, with intense assiduity, he continued the composition of his works. Meanwhile, he had written to Abu Yafa, the prefect of the dynamic city of Isfahan, offering his services. The new emir of Hamadan, hearing of this correspondence and discovering where Ibn Sina was hiding, incarcerated him in a fortress. War meanwhile continued between the rulers of Isfahan and Hamadan. In 1024 the former captured Hamadan and its towns, expelling the Tajik mercenaries. When the storm had passed, Ibn Sina returned with the emir to Hamadan, and carried on his literary labors. Later, however, accompanied by his brother, a favorite pupil, and two slaves, Ibn Sina escaped from the city in the dress of a Sufi ascetic. After a perilous journey, they reached Isfahan, receiving an honorable welcome from the prince. Later life and death. The remaining 10 or 12 years of Ibn Sina's life were spent in the service of the Kakuyid ruler Muhammad ibn Rustam Dushman Siyar, whom he accompanied as physician and general literary and scientific advisor, even in his numerous campaigns. During these years he began to study literary matters and philology, instigated, it is asserted, by criticisms on his style. A severe colic, which seized him on the march of the army against Hamadan, was checked by remedies so violent that Ibn Sina could scarcely stand. On a similar occasion the disease returned. With difficulty he reached Hamadan, where, finding the disease gaining ground, he refused to keep up the regimen imposed, and resigned himself to his fate. His friends advised him to slow down and take life moderately. He refused, however, stating that, I prefer a short life with width to a narrow one with length. On his deathbed remorse seized him. He bestowed his goods on the poor, restored unjust gains, freed his slaves, and read through the Quran every 3 days until his death. He died in June 1037, in his 58th year, in the month of Ramadan, and was buried in Hamadan, Iran. Avicenna's philosophy. Ibn Sina wrote extensively on early Islamic philosophy, especially the subjects logic, ethics, and metaphysics, including treatises named Logic and Metaphysics. Most of his works were written in Arabic, which was the scientific language of the time in the Middle East, and some were written in the Persian language. Of linguistic significance even to this day are a few books that he wrote in nearly pure Persian language, particularly the Dashnami e Alabama, Philosophy for Alabama e Dola. Ibn Sina's commentaries on Aristotle often criticized the philosopher, encouraging a lively debate in the spirit of ijtihad. In the medieval Islamic world, due to Avicenna's successful reconciliation between Aristotelianism and Neoplatonism along with Kalam, Avicennism eventually became the leading school of Islamic philosophy by the 12th century, with Avicenna becoming a central authority on philosophy. Avicennism was also influential in medieval Europe, particularly his doctrines on the nature of the soul and his existence-essence distinction, along with the debates and censure that they raised in scholastic Europe. This was particularly the case in Paris, where Avicennism was later proscribed in 1210. Nevertheless, his psychology and theory of knowledge influenced William of Avenne, Bishop of Paris, and Albertus Magnus, while his metaphysics had an impact on the thought of Thomas Aquinas. Metaphysical doctrine. Early Islamic philosophy and Islamic metaphysics, imbued as it is with Islamic theology, distinguishes more clearly than Aristotelianism between essence and existence. Whereas existence is the domain of the contingent and the accidental, essence endures within a being beyond the accidental. The philosophy of Ibn Sina, particularly that part relating to metaphysics, owes much to Al-Farabi. The search for a definitive Islamic philosophy separate from occasionalism can be seen in what is left of his work. Following Al-Farabi's lead, Avicenna initiated a full-fledged inquiry into the question of being, in which he distinguished between essence, ma'iyat, and existence, wujud. He argued that the fact of existence cannot be inferred from or accounted for by the essence of existing things, and that form and matter by themselves cannot interact and originate the movement of the universe or the progressive actualization of existing things. Existence must, therefore, be due to an agent cause that necessitates, imparts, gives, or adds existence to an essence. To do so, the cause must be an existing thing and coexist with its effect. Avicenna's consideration of the essence attributes question may be elucidated in terms of his ontological analysis of the modalities of being, namely impossibility, contingency, and necessity. Avicenna argued that the impossible being is that which cannot exist, while the contingent in itself, mumkin by itahi, has the potentiality to be or not to be without entailing a contradiction. When actualized, the contingent becomes a necessary existent due to what is other than itself, wajib al-wujud by ghairihi. Thus, contingency in itself is potential beingness that could eventually be actualized by an external cause other than itself. The metaphysical structures of necessity and contingency are different. Necessary being due to itself, wajib al-wujud by itahi, is true in itself, while the contingent being is false in itself and true due to something else other than itself. The necessary is the source of its own being without borrowed existence. It is what always exists. The necessary exists due to itself, and has no quiddity, essence, mayur, other than existence, wujud. Furthermore, it is one, wahid ahad, since there cannot be more than one necessary existent due to itself without differentia, fasl, to distinguish them from each other. Yet, to require differentia entails that they exist due to themselves as well as due to what is other than themselves, and this is contradictory. However, if no differentia distinguishes them from each other, then there is no sense in which these existents are not one and the same. Avicenna adds that the necessary existent due to itself has no genus, gens, nor a definition, had, nor a counterpart, nad, nor an opposite, did, and is detached, bari, from matter, madder, quality, kaif, quantity, kam, place, ein, situation, wad, and time, waqt. Al-Biruni correspondence. Correspondence between Ibn Sina, with his student Al-Mahd ibn Ali al-Masumi, and Abu Rayhan al-Biruni has survived, in which they debated Aristotelian natural philosophy and the peripatetic school. Abu Rayhan began by asking Avicenna 18 questions, 10 of which were criticisms of Aristotle's On the Heavens theology. Ibn Sina was a devout Muslim and sought to reconcile rational philosophy with Islamic theology. His aim was to prove the existence of God and his creation of the world scientifically and through reason and logic. Avicenna's views on Islamic theology and philosophy were enormously influential, forming part of the core of the curriculum at Islamic religious schools until the 19th century. Avicenna wrote a number of short treatises dealing with Islamic theology. These included treatises on the Islamic prophets, whom he viewed as inspired philosophers, and also on various scientific and philosophical interpretations of the Quran, such as how Quranic cosmology corresponds to his own philosophical system. In general, these treatises linked his philosophical writings to Islamic religious ideas, for example, the body's afterlife. There are occasional brief hints and allusions in his longer works, however, that he considered philosophy as the only sensible way to distinguish real prophecy from illusion. He did not state this more clearly because of the political implications of such a theory, if prophecy could be questioned, and also because most of the time he was writing shorter works which concentrated on explaining his theories on philosophy and theology clearly, without digressing to consider epistemological matters which could only be properly considered by other philosophers. Later interpretations of his philosophy split into three different schools: those, such as Al-Tusi, who continued to apply his philosophy as a system to interpret later political events and scientific advances; those, such as Al-Razi, who considered Avicenna's theological works in isolation from his wider philosophical concerns; and those, such as Al-Ghazali, who selectively used parts of his philosophy to support their own attempts to gain greater spiritual insights through a variety of mystical means. It was the theological interpretation championed by those such as Al-Razi which eventually came to predominate in the madrasas. Ibn Sina memorized the Quran by the age of 10, and as an adult, He wrote five treatises commenting on surahs from the Quran. One of these texts included the proof of prophecies, in which he comments on several Quranic verses and holds the Quran in high esteem. Avicenna argued that the Islamic prophets should be considered higher than philosophers. Thought experiments. While he was imprisoned in the castle of Fardajan near Hamadan, Avicenna wrote his famous floating man, literally falling man, thought experiment to demonstrate human self-awareness and the substantiality and immateriality of the soul. Avicenna believed his floating man thought experiment demonstrated that the soul is a substance, and claimed humans cannot doubt their own consciousness, even in a situation that prevents all sensory data input. The thought experiment told its readers to imagine themselves created all at once while suspended in the air, isolated from all sensations, which includes no sensory contact with even their own bodies. He argued that, in this scenario, one would still have self-consciousness, because it is conceivable that a person, suspended in air while cut off from sense experience, would still be capable of determining his own existence. The thought experiment points to the conclusions that the soul is a perfection, independent of the body, and an immaterial substance. The conceivability of this floating man indicates that the soul is perceived intellectually, which entails the soul's separateness from the body. Avicenna referred to the living human intelligence, particularly the active intellect, which he believed to be the hypostasis by which God communicates truth to the human mind and imparts order and intelligibility to nature. Following is an English translation of the argument. One of us has to consider, yatawaham, that one has been just created in a stroke, and that one has been thus created fully developed and perfectly complete, kamilan, yet, created, with one's vision shrouded, or veiled, qg babazaru, from watching, perceiving, mushahadat, external entities created falling, floating, ya, in the air on an empty space, al-kala, in a fall not buffeted by any felt air that buffers it, that is the person in question, its limbs separated and not in contact nor touching on another. Then let it contemplate, yatuiml, whether it would affirm the existence of its own self. It would not then doubt the affirmation that its self is existent, Mujida, yet not affirming the existence of any other limbs nor inner bowels, nor heart, nor brain, nor anything of the external things. Rather it was affirming the existence of itself without affirming that it had length, breadth, or depth, and if it were possible for it, in such a state, to imagine, yatukail, a hand or any other limb, it would not then imagine it to be part of itself nor to be condition of it. That is its self-existence. And you know that what is affirmed is distinct from what is not affirmed, and what is implied is distinct from what is not implied. Therefore the nafs, self, soul, whose existence the person has affirmed, is its, the person's, characteristic identity that is not identical to its body nor its limbs, whose existence it did not affirm. Therefore, the attentive, al-mutanabbih, to this situation, as a means of realizing, yatanaba, that the affirmation of the existence of itself, soul, al-nafs, is distinct from the body and something that is quite non-body, that is that the mind, soul, al-nafs, is distinct from the body, jism, this is known though self-consciousness, and if one was distracted from it, one needs to knock one's baton, as to be alerted to it. Ibn Sina, Kait Abal Shifa, on the soul. However, Avicenna posited the brain as the place where reason interacts with sensation. Sensation prepares the soul to receive rational concepts from the universal agent intellect. The first knowledge of the flying person would be I am, affirming his or her essence. That essence could not be the body, obviously, as the flying person has no sensation. Thus, the knowledge that I am is the core of a human being. The soul exists and is self-aware. Avicenna thus concluded that the idea of the self is not logically dependent on any physical thing, and that the soul should not be seen in relative terms, but as a primary given, a substance. The body is unnecessary. In relation to it, the soul is its perfection. In itself, the soul is an immaterial substance. About 100 treatises were ascribed to Ibn Sina. Some of them are tracts of a few pages, others are works extending through several volumes. His 14-volume The Canon of Medicine, Al-Qanun fi al-Tibb, The Laws of Medicine, was a standard medical text in Europe and the Islamic world until the 17th century. Medicine and pharmacology. The book is known for its description of contagious diseases and sexually transmitted diseases, quarantine to limit the spread of infectious diseases, and testing of medicines. Like the Greeks, Ibn Sina supported the miasma theory of disease, which postulates that vapors in the air are the cause of epidemics. It classifies and describes diseases, and outlines their assumed causes. Hygiene, simple and complex medicines, and functions of parts of the body are also covered. The canon agrees with Aristotle, and disagrees with Hippocrates, that tuberculosis was contagious, a fact which was not universally accepted in Europe until centuries later. It also describes the symptoms and complications of diabetes. Both forms of facial paralysis were described in depth. The canon of medicine discussed how to effectively test new medicines. The drug must be free from any extraneous accidental quality. It must be used on a simple, not a composite, disease. The drug must be tested with two contrary types of diseases, because sometimes a drug cures one disease by its essential qualities and another by its accidental ones. The quality of the drug must correspond to the strength of the disease. For example, there are some drugs whose heat is less than the coldness of certain diseases, so that they would have no effect on them. The time of action must be observed, so that essence and accident are not confused. The effect of the drug must be seen to occur constantly or in many cases, for if this did not happen, it was an accidental effect. The experimentation must be done with the human body, for testing a drug on a lion or a horse might not prove anything about its effect on man. An Arabic edition of the canon appeared at Rome in 1593, and a Hebrew version at Naples in 1491. Of the Latin version there were about 30 editions, founded on the original translation by Gerard de Sablonita. In the 15th century a commentary on the text of the canon was composed. Other medical works translated into Latin are the Medicamenta Cordialia, Canticum de Medicina, and the Tractatus de Siripositozo. It was mainly accident which determined that from the 12th to the 17th century, Ibn Sina should be the guide of medical study in European universities, and eclipse the names of Razi's, Ali ibn al-Abbas and Averroes. His work is not essentially different from that of his predecessor Razi's, because he presented the doctrine of Galen, and through Galen the doctrine of Hippocrates, modified by the system of Aristotle. But the canon of Ibn Sina is distinguished from the al-Hu'i, continence, or summary of Razi's by its greater method, due perhaps to the logical studies of the former. The work has been variously appreciated in subsequent ages, some regarding it as a treasury of wisdom, and others, like Averroes, holding it useful only as waste paper. In modern times it has been mainly of historic interest as most of its tenets have been disproved or expanded upon by scientific medicine. The vice of the book is excessive classification of bodily faculties, and over-subtlety in the discrimination of diseases. It includes 5 books, of which the first and second discuss physiology, pathology and hygiene, the third and fourth deal with the methods of treating disease, and the fifth describes the composition and preparation of remedies. This last part contains some personal observations. He is ample in the enumeration of symptoms, and is said to be inferior in practical medicine and surgery. He introduced into medical theory the 4 causes of the peripatetic system. Of natural history and botany he pretended to no special knowledge. Up to the year 1650, or thereabouts, the canon was still used as a textbook in the universities of Leuven and Montpellier. In the museum at Bukhara, there are displays showing many of his writings, surgical instruments from the period and paintings of patients undergoing treatment. Ibn Sina was interested in the effect of the mind on the body, and wrote a great deal on psychology, likely influencing Ibn Tufayl and Ibn Badger. He also introduced medical herbs. Avicenna extended the theory of temperaments in the canon of medicine to encompass emotional aspects, mental capacity, moral attitudes, self-awareness, movements and dreams. The canon of medicine. Volume 1 of 5, Part 4 of 5, The Preservation of Health. Of Ibn Sina's Canon of Medicine, which is written in 5 volumes, only the first volume has appeared in the English language. In the first volume, Ibn Sina divides medicine into two parts as he explains it throughout the first book, the theoretical and the practical. The theoretical part consists of, but is not limited to, such things as the causes of health and disease, the temperaments, the humors, anatomy, general physiology, the breath, psychology, discussion of causes of diseases and symptoms, the causes of illness, the classification of diseases, the pulse, the urine, etc. As he himself says in the book on page 353, in the first part of this book it was stated that medicine comprises two parts, one theoretical, and one practical, though both are really speculative science. Avicenna, 1999, p. 353, Theoretical and Practical Medicine. Ibn Sina goes on to say that you do not get any benefit from just knowing how your body works, but rather the true benefit of medicine itself is in its practical aspect, since medicine is for the preservation of health. That which is speculative named theory relates to the formation of opinions and the showing of the evidence upon which they are based, without reference to the mode of acting upon them. Thus this part deals with the temperaments, the humors, the drives, and with the forms, the symptoms, and the causes of disease. That which is specially named practical relates to the mode of acting upon this knowledge, and the prescription of a regimen. Avicenna, 1999, p. 353. The benefits of exercise. Once the purpose of medicine has been set forth, then from pages 377 to 455, Ibn Sina divides the way of achieving health as, since the regimen of maintaining health consists essentially in the regulation of 1. Exercise, 2. Food and 3. Sleep, we may begin our discourse with the subject of exercise. Avicenna, 1999, p. 377. Exercise itself is divided into three main parts: the massage, which is equivalent to massaging your muscles before you start to exercise, the exercise itself, and lastly the cold bath. Giving one of the greatest benefits of the regimen of exercise, and then explaining the extremely important and necessary need for physical exercise, Ibn Sina states, once we direct the attention towards regulating exercise as to amount and time, we shall find there is no need for such medicines as are ordinarily required for remedying diseases dependent on abnormal matters, or diseases of temperament consequent upon such. This is true provided the rest of the regimen is appropriate and proper. Avicenna, 1999, p. 377. The value of exercise includes the following: 1. It hardens the organs and renders them fit for their functions. 2. It results in a better absorption of food, aids assimilation, and, by increasing the innate heat, improves nutrition. 3. It clears the pores of the skin. 4. It removes effete substances through the lungs. 5. It strengthens the physique. Vigorous exercise invigorates the muscular and nervous system. Avicenna, 1999, p. 379. In what manner does Ibn Sina uses the word temperament in saying that exercise cures diseases of temperament? Ibn Sina divides temperament into that which is harmonious and that which is non-uniform. Ibn Sina says on pages 276 to 277, in addition to the signs of the normal temperament already given, there are mental faculties including vigor of imagination, intellectual power, and memory. Avicenna, 1999, p. 276. In brief, there is non-uniformity of temperament among the members, or, perchance, the principal members depart from equability and come to be of contrary temperament, one deviating towards one, another to its contrary. If the components of the body are out of proportion, it is unfortunate both for talent and reasoning power. Avicenna, 1999, p. 277. The purpose of exercise and the dangers of its negligence. Continuing on the proof to why exercise should be so beneficial, Ibn Sina says we know that this must be so when we reflect how, in regard to nutriment, Our health depends on the nutriment being appropriate for us and regulated in quantity and quality. For not one of the elements which are capable of nourishing the body is converted into actual nutriment in its entirety. In every case, digestion leaves something untouched, and nature takes care to have that evacuated. Nevertheless, the evacuation which nature accomplishes is not a complete one. Hence, at the end of each digestion there is some superfluity left over. Should this be a frequent occurrence, repetition would lead to further aggregation until something measurable has accumulated. As a result, harmful effete substances would form and injure various parts of the body. When they undergo decomposition, putrefactive diseases arise, bacterial infections. Should they be strong in quality, they will give rise to intemperament, and if they should increase in quantity, they would set up the symptoms of plethora which have already been described. Flowing to some member, they will result in an inflammatory mass, and their vapors will destroy the temperament of the substantial basis of the breath. That is the reason why we must be careful to evacuate these substances. Their evacuation is usually not completely accomplished without the aid of toxic medicines, for these break up the nature of the effete substances. This can be achieved only by toxic agents, although the drinking of them is to a certain extent deleterious to our nature. As Hippocrates says, medicine purges and ages. More than this, the discharge of superfluous humor entails the loss of a large part of the natural humidities and of the breath, which is the substance of life. All this is at the expense of the strength of the principal and the auxiliary members, and therefore they are weakened thereby. These and other things account for the difficulties incident to plethora, whether they remain behind in the body or are evacuated by it. Avicenna, 1999, pages 377-8. Just before this, Ibn Sina explained how accumulation of food in our body can cause diseases, and one way to rid us of this is strong medicines. However, as he explains, this is not the ideal way, and certainly not the long term. Thus, to make his point very clear, and show the extreme necessity of daily exercise for health, Ibn Sina states, "Now exercise is that agent which most surely prevents the accumulation of these matters, and prevents plethora. The other forms of regimen assist it. It is this exercise which renews and revives the innate heat, and imparts the necessary lightness to the body, for it causes the subtle heat to be increased and daily disperses whatever effete substances have accumulated. The movements of the body help them to expel them, conveying them to those parts of the body whence they can readily leave it. Hence the effete matters are not allowed to collect day after day, and besides this, as we have just said, exercise causes the innate heat to flourish and keeps the joints and ligaments firm, so as to be always ready for service, and also free from injury. It renders the members able to receive nutriment, in being free from accumulated effete matters. Hence it renders the members light and the humidities attenuated, and it dilates the pores of the skin. To forsake exercise would often incur the risk of hectic, because the instinctive drives of the members are impaired, inasmuch as the deprivation of movement prevents the access to them of the innate breath, and this last is the real instrument of life for every one of the members. Avicenna, 1999, pages 378-9. Massage. Before you begin to exercise, it is important that you massage your muscles, as Ibn Sina says on page 385. Massage as a preparatory to athletics. The massage begins gently, and then becomes more vigorous as the time approaches for the exercise. Avicenna, 1999, p. 385. Exercises. The exercises themselves are divided into strenuous, mild, vigorous and brisk. On pages 379-381, Ibn Sina states the types of exercises under each type. Strenuous exercises include wrestling contests, boxing, quick marching, running, jumping over an object higher than 1 foot, throwing the javelin, fencing, horsemanship, swimming. Mild exercises include fishing, sailing, being carried on camels, swinging to and fro. Vigorous exercises include those performed by soldiers in camp, in military sports, field running, long jumping, high jumping, polo, stone throwing, lifting heavy stones or weights, Various forms of wrestling. Brisk exercises include, involves interchanging places with a partner as swiftly as possible, each jumping to and fro, either in time, to music, or irregularly. Avicenna, 1999, pages 379-81. There are certain important things to note once you start exercising. One is the amount, the other consistency. Ibn Sina states about the amount. 1. The color. As long as the skin goes on becoming florid, the exercise may be continued. After it ceases to do so, the exercise must be discontinued. Avicenna, 1999, p. 384. On being consistent with exercise, Ibn Sina states, on the importance of having a regimen. At the conclusion of the first day's exercise, you will know the degree of exercise allowable, and when you know the amount of nourishment the person can bear, do not make any change in either on the second day. Arrange that the measure of aliment and the amount of exercise shall not exceed the limit ascertained on the first day. Avicenna, 1999, p. 385. On the side note, those who think themselves to be elderly, and thus think of shunning exercise, Ibn Sina write a complete chapter titled Concerning the Elderly in the Canon, and states the same regimen for them, as he does for others. He states on page 433, for if, towards the end of life, the body is still equable, it will be right to allow tempered exercises. If one part of the body should not be in a first-rate condition, then that part should not be exercised until the others have been exercised. On the other hand, if the ailment were in the feet, then the exercise should employ the upper limbs, for instance, rowing, throwing weights, lifting weights. Avicenna, 1999, p. 433. Bathing in cold water. Once you have finished exercising, it is often that the person will feel tired and fatigued. To combat this problem, Ibn Sina says on page 388, the beneficial effects of baths. The benefits are: 1. Induction of sleep. 2. Dilation of pores. 3. Cleansing of skin. 4. Dispersal of the undesirable waste matters. 5. Maturation of abscesses. 6. Drawing of nutriment towards the surface of the body. 7. Assistance to the physiological dispersion and excretion of poisonous matters. 8. Prevention of diarrhea, and 9. Removal of fatigue effects. Avicenna, 1999, p. 388. Most importantly, you should remember, a person should not go into the bath immediately after exercise. He should rest properly first. Avicenna, 1999, p. 387. There are two more things that are important to mention on this subject. Injurious effects include the fact that the heart is weakened if the person stays too long in the bath. Avicenna, 1999, p. 388. Cold bathing should not be done after exercise except in the case of the very robust. Even then, the rules which we have given should be followed. To use cold baths in the ways we have named drives the natural heat suddenly into the interior parts, and then invigorates the strength so that the person should leave the bath twice as strong as when he entered. Avicenna, 1999, p. 390. Diet. Once Ibn Sina has laid the foundation of exercise being central to health, he names many exercises as running, swimming, weightlifting, polo, fencing, boxing, wrestling, long jumping, high jumping, etc. He also gives a diet to go along with the exercise. The meal should include: 1. Meat, especially kid of goats, veal, and year-old lambs. This means white meat in today's terms. 2. Wheat, which is cleaned of extraneous matter and gathered during a healthy harvest without ever being exposed to injurious influences. 3. Sweets, fruits, of appropriate temperament. Avicenna, 1999, p. 390. Lastly, the third thing mentioned is sleep. To make sure that you do not sleep during the days, and do not stay awake during the nights. From the above reading, it is clear that Ibn Sina gave advice in his book, which is still the same advice medical doctors give to their patients. Daily physical exercise, and to defeat diseases such as type 2 diabetes, high blood pressure, The prescription of a diet which contains high amounts of whole grains and little to no amounts of refined carbohydrates. Avicenna 1999, p. 390. Psychology. In the Canon of Medicine, Avicenna described a number of conditions, including melancholia. He described melancholia as a depressive type of mood disorder in which the person may become suspicious and develop certain types of phobias. Unani Medicine main article, Unani Medicine. Though the threads which comprise Unani healing can be traced all the way back to Galen of Pergamon, who lived in the 2nd century AD, the basic knowledge of Unani medicine as a healing system was developed by Hakim ibn Sina in his medical encyclopedia The Canon of Medicine. The time of origin is thus stated at circa 1025 AD, when Avicenna wrote the Canon of Medicine in Persia, which remains a textbook in the syllabus of Unani medicine in the colleges of India and Pakistan. Earth sciences. Ibn Sina wrote on earth sciences such as geology in the Book of Healing. While discussing the formation of mountains, he explained, either they are the effects of upheavals of the crust of the earth, such as might occur during a violent earthquake, or they are the effect of water, which, cutting itself a new route, has denuded the valleys, the strata being of different kinds, some soft, some hard. It would require a long period of time for all such changes to be accomplished, during which the mountains themselves might be somewhat diminished in size. Philosophy of science. In the Al-Burhan, on demonstration, section of the Book of Healing, Avicenna discussed the philosophy of science and described an early scientific method of inquiry. He discusses Aristotle's posterior analytics and significantly diverged from it on several points. Avicenna discussed the issue of a proper methodology for scientific inquiry and the question of how does one acquire the first principles of a science. He asked how a scientist would arrive at the initial axioms or hypotheses of a deductive science without inferring them from some more basic premises. He explains that the ideal situation is when one grasps that a relation holds between the terms, which would allow for absolute, universal certainty. Avicenna then adds two further methods for arriving at the first principles: the ancient Aristotelian method of induction, istikra, and the method of examination and experimentation, tajriba. Avicenna criticized Aristotelian induction, arguing that it does not lead to the absolute, universal, and certain premises that it purports to provide. In its place, he develops a method of experimentation as a means for scientific inquiry. Logic. An early formal system of temporal logic was studied by Avicenna. Although he did not develop a real theory of temporal propositions, he did study the relationship between temporalis and the implication. Avicenna's work was further developed by Najmuddin al-Qazwini al-Qutaybi and became the dominant system of Islamic logic until modern times. Avicennian logic also influenced several early European logicians such as Albertus Magnus and William of Ockham. Physics. In mechanics, Ibn Sina, in the Book of Healing, developed an elaborate theory of motion, in which he made a distinction between the inclination, tendency to motion, and force of a projectile, and concluded that motion was a result of an inclination, male, transferred to the projectile by the thrower, and that projectile motion in a vacuum would not cease. He viewed inclination as a permanent force whose effect is dissipated by external forces such as air resistance. The theory of motion developed by Avicenna may have influenced Jean Buridan's theory of impetus, the ancestor of the inertia and momentum concepts. In optics, Ibn Sina was among those who argued that light had a speed, observing that if the perception of light is due to the emission of some sort of particles by a luminous source, the speed of light must be finite. He also provided a wrong explanation of the rainbow phenomenon. Carl Benjamin Boyer described Avicenna's, Ibn Sina, theory on the rainbow as follows. Independent observation had demonstrated to him that the bow is not formed in the dark cloud but rather in the very thin mist lying between the cloud and the sun or observer. The cloud, he thought, serves simply as the background of this thin substance, much as a quicksilver lining is placed upon the rear surface of the glass in a mirror. Ibn Sina would change the place not only of the bow, but also of the color formation, holding the iridescence to be merely a subjective sensation in the eye. In 1253, a Latin text entitled Speculum Tripartitum stated the following regarding Avicenna's theory on heat. Avicenna says in his book of Heaven and Earth, that heat is generated from motion in external things. Psychology. Avicenna's legacy in classical psychology is primarily embodied in the Kitab al-Nafs, parts of his Kitab al-Shifa, the Book of Healing, and Kitab al-Najat, the Book of Deliverance. These were known in Latin under the title De Anima, treatises on the soul. The main thesis of these tracts is represented in his so-called flying man argument, which resonates with what was centuries later entailed by Descartes' cogito argument, or what phenomenology designates as a form of an epoch. Avicenna's psychology requires that connection between the body and soul be strong enough to ensure the soul's individuation, but weak enough to allow for its immortality. Avicenna grounds his psychology on physiology, which means his account of the soul is one that deals almost entirely with the natural science of the body and its abilities of perception. Thus, the philosopher's connection between the soul and body is explained almost entirely by his understanding of perception. In this way, bodily perception interrelates with the immaterial human intellect. In sense perception, the perceiver senses the form of the object, first, by perceiving features of the object by our external senses. This sensory information is supplied to the internal senses, which merge all the pieces into a whole, unified conscious experience. This process of perception and abstraction is the nexus of the soul and body, for the material body may only perceive material objects, while the immaterial soul may only receive the immaterial, universal forms. The way the soul and body interact in the final abstraction of the universal from the concrete particular is the key to their relationship and interaction, which takes place in the physical body. The soul completes the action of intellection by accepting forms that have been abstracted from matter. This process requires a concrete particular, material, to be abstracted into the universal intelligible, immaterial. The material and immaterial interact through the active intellect, which is a divine light containing the intelligible forms. The active intellect reveals the universals concealed in material objects, much like the sun makes color available to our eyes. Other contributions: astronomy and astrology. Avicenna wrote an attack on astrology titled Risala Fitl Arkam al-Nujum, in which he cited passages from the Quran to dispute the power of astrology to foretell the future. He believed that each planet had some influence on the earth, but argued against astrologers being able to determine the exact effects. Avicenna's astronomical writings had some influence on later writers, although in general his work could be considered less developed than Al-Hazen or Al-Biruni. One important feature of his writing is that he considers mathematical astronomy as a separate discipline to astrology. He criticized Aristotle's view of the stars receiving their light from the sun, stating that the stars are self-luminous, and believed that the planets are also self-luminous. He claimed to have observed Venus as a spot on the Sunday. This is possible, as there was a transit on May 24, 1032, but Avicenna did not give the date of his observation, and modern scholars have questioned whether he could have observed the transit from his location at that time. He may have mistaken a sunspot for Venus. He used his transit observation to help establish that Venus was, at least sometimes, below the sun in Ptolemaic cosmology. That is, the sphere of Venus comes before the sphere of the Sun when moving out from the Earth in the prevailing geocentric model. He also wrote the summary of the Almagest, based on Ptolemy's Almagest, with an appended treatise to bring that which is stated in the Almagest and what is understood from natural science into conformity. For example, Avicenna considers the motion of the solar apogee, which Ptolemy had taken to be fixed. Chemistry. Ibn Sina used distillation to produce essential oils such as rose essence, forming the foundation of what later became aromatherapy. Unlike, for example, Al-Razi, Ibn Sina explicitly disputed the theory of the transmutation of substances commonly believed by alchemists. Those of the chemical craft know well that no change can be effected in the different species of substances, though they can produce the appearance of such change. Four works on alchemy attributed to Avicenna were translated into Latin as Libra Boeli Abincinda Anima Inati Alchemia Declaratio Lapis Physici Avicenni Filio Suia Boeli Avicennida Congelation et Conglutination Lapidum Avicenni Ad Hassan Regim Epistola di Rerecta. Libra Boeli Abincinda Anima Inati Alchemia was the most influential, having influenced later medieval chemists and alchemists such as Vincent of Vise. However, Anawati argues, following Ruska, that the De Anima is a fake by a Spanish author. Similarly, the Declaratio is believed not to be actually by Avicenna. The third work, the Book of Minerals, is agreed to be Avicenna's writing, adapted from the Kitab al-Shifa, Book of the Remedy. Ibn Sina classified minerals into stones, fusible substances, sulfurs, and salts, building on the ideas of Aristotle and Jabir. The Epistola di Rerectu is somewhat less skeptical of alchemy. Anawati argues that it is by Avicenna, but written earlier in his career when he had not yet firmly decided that transmutation was impossible. Poetry. Almost half of Ibn Sina's works are versified. His poems appear in both Arabic and Persian. As an example, Edward Granville Brown claims that the following Persian verses are incorrectly attributed to Omar Khayyam, and were originally written by Ibn Sina. Up from Earth's center through the seventh gate, I rose, and on the throne of Saturn sate, and many knots unraveled by the road, but not the master knot of human fate. As early as the 14th century, when Dante Alighieri depicted him in limbo alongside the virtuous non-Christian thinkers in his Divine Comedy such as Virgil, Averroes, Homer, Horace, Ovid, Lucan, Socrates, Plato, and Saladin, Avicenna has been recognized by both East and West as one of the great figures in intellectual history. George Sarton, the author of The History of Science, described Ibn Sina as one of the greatest thinkers and medical scholars in history and called him the most famous scientist of Islam and one of the most famous of all races, places, and times. He was one of the Islamic world's leading writers in the field of medicine. Along with Razi's, Abulkasis, Ibn al-Nafis, and Ali Badi, Ibn Sina is considered an important compiler of early Muslim medicine. He is remembered in the Western history of medicine as a major historical figure who made important contributions to medicine and the European Renaissance. His medical texts were unusual in that where controversy existed between Galen and Aristotle's views on medical matters, such as anatomy, he preferred to side with Aristotle, where necessary updating Aristotle's position to take into account post-Aristotelian advances in anatomical knowledge. Aristotle's dominant intellectual influence among medieval European scholars meant that Avicenna's linking of Galen's medical writings with Aristotle's philosophical writings in the Canon of Medicine, along with its comprehensive and logical organization of knowledge, significantly increased Avicenna's importance in medieval Europe in comparison to other Islamic writers on medicine. His influence following translation of the canon was such that from the early 14th to the mid-16th centuries, he was ranked with Hippocrates and Galen as one of the acknowledged authorities, Princeps Medicorum, Prince of Physicians. In Iran, he is considered a national icon, and is often regarded as one of the greatest Persians to have ever lived. Many portraits and statues remain in Iran today. An impressive monument to the life and works of the man who is known as the Doctor of Doctors still stands outside the Bukhara Museum, and his portrait hangs in the hall of the Avicenna Faculty of Medicine in the University of Paris. There is also a crater on the moon named Avicenna and a plant genus Avicennia, Ba'ali Sina University in Hamadan, Iran. The Ibn Sina Tajik State Medical University in Dushanbe, Ibn Sina Academy of Medieval Medicine and Sciences at Aligarh, India, Avicenna School in Karachi and Avicenna Medical College in Lahore, Pakistan. Ibn Sina Bork Medical School in his native province of Bork in Afghanistan, Ibn Sina Faculty of Medicine of Ankara University, Ankara, Turkey, and Ibn Sina Integrated School in Marae City, Philippines, are all named in his honor. In 1980, the former Soviet Union, which then ruled his birthplace Bukhara, celebrated the 1000th anniversary of Avicenna's birth by circulating various commemorative stamps with artistic illustrations, and by erecting a bust of Avicenna based on anthropological research by Soviet scholars. Near his birthplace in Kislyak of Shona, some 25 kilometers 16 miles north of Bukhara, a training college for medical staff has been named for him. On the grounds is a museum dedicated to his life, times and work. Google Earth, see. The Avicenna Prize for Ethics in Science is awarded every 2 years by UNESCO and rewards individuals and groups in the field of ethics in science. The prize was named after Avicenna. The aim of the award is to promote ethical reflection on issues raised by advances in science and technology, and to raise global awareness of the importance of ethics in science. In March 2008, it was announced that Avicenna's name would be used for new directories of education institutions for healthcare professionals worldwide. The Avicenna directories will list universities and schools where doctors, public health practitioners, pharmacists and others are educated. The project team stated why Avicenna was noted for his synthesis of knowledge from both East and West. He has had a lasting influence on the development of medicine and health sciences. The use of Avicenna's name symbolizes the worldwide partnership that is needed for the promotion of health services of high quality. Arabic works. The treatises of Ibn Sina influenced later Muslim thinkers in many areas, including theology, philology, mathematics, astronomy, physics, and music. Ibn Sina's works numbered almost 450 volumes on a wide range of subjects, of which around 240 have survived. In particular, 150 volumes of his surviving works concentrate on philosophy and 40 of them concentrate on medicine. His most famous works are the Book of Healing, a vast philosophical and scientific encyclopedia, and the Canon of Medicine. Ibn Sina wrote at least one treatise on alchemy, but several others have been falsely attributed to him. His book on animals was translated by Michael Scott. His Logic, Metaphysics, Physics, and Decalo are treatises giving a synoptic view of Aristotelian doctrine, though the Metaphysics demonstrates a significant departure from the brand of Neoplatonism known as Aristotelianism. In Ibn Sina's world, Arabic philosophers have hinted at the idea that Ibn Sina was attempting to re-Aristotelianize Muslim philosophy in its entirety, unlike his predecessors, who accepted the conflation of Platonic, Aristotelian, Neo and Middle Platonic works transmitted into the Muslim world. The Logic and Metaphysics have been extensively reprinted, the latter, for example, at Venice in 1493, 1495, and 1546. Some of his shorter essays on medicine, logic, etc., take a poetical form. The poem on logic was published by Schmulders in 1836. Two encyclopedic treatises, dealing with philosophy, are often mentioned. The larger, Al-Shifa, Sanatio, exists nearly complete in manuscript in the Bodleian Library and elsewhere. Part of it on the De Anima appeared at Pavia, 1490, as the Liber Sextus Naturalium, and the long account of Ibn Sina's philosophy given by Muhammad al-Sharistani seems to be mainly an analysis, and in many places a reproduction, of the Al-Shifa. A shorter form of the work is known as the An-Najat, Liberatio. The Latin editions of part of these works have been modified by the corrections which the monastic editors confess that they applied. There is also a Hikmat al-Mashriqiyyah, in Latin Philosophia Orientalis, mentioned by Roger Bacon, the majority of which is lost in antiquity, which according to Averroes was pantheistic in tone. Persian works. New Persian, the native language of Avicenna, was not a scientific language until the 10th century. However, Avicenna became one of the pioneers in writing New Persian scientific language. Danish Nima Ili. Danish Nima Ili is called the Book of Knowledge for Prince Alabama Adola. One of Avicenna's important Persian work is the Danish Naim, literally, the Book of Knowledge, for Prince Alabama Adola, the local Buyid ruler. The linguist aspects of the Danes' Nama and the originality of their Persian vocabulary are of great interest to Iranian philologists. Avicenna created new scientific vocabulary that had not existed before in the modern Persian language. The Danes' Nama covers such topics as logic, metaphysics, music theory and other sciences of his time. This book has been translated into English by Parwiz Mawaj. The book is also important in respect to Persian scientific works. And Ardaneshirag is called On the Science of the Pulse. This book contains 9 chapters on the science of the pulse and is a condensed synopsis. Persian poetry. Persian poetry from Ibn Sina is recorded in various manuscripts and later anthologies such as Nuzhat al-Majals. In popular culture, the male name Sina, also spelled Sina, which more closely reflects the Persian pronunciation, is a common name in Afghanistan, Iran and Turkey. This popularity is due to the respect for Avicenna, the walking drum. In Louis Lama's 1985 historical novel The Walking Drum, Kerbouchard studies and discusses Avicenna's The Canon of Medicine. The Physician. In his book The Physician, 1988, Noah Gordon tells the story of a young English medical apprentice who disguises himself as a Jew to travel from England to Persia and learn from Avicenna, the great master of his time. The novel was adapted into a feature film, The Physician, in 2013. Avicenna was played by Ben Kingsley. Ching the Young. He also studied fiqh, Islamic jurisprudence, under the Hanafi scholar Ismail al-Sahid. As a teenager, he was greatly troubled by the metaphysics of Aristotle, which he could not understand until he read al-Farabi's commentary on the work. For the next year and a half, he studied philosophy, in which he encountered greater obstacles. In such moments of baffled inquiry, he would leave his books, perform the requisite ablutions, then go to the mosque, and continue in prayer till light broke on his difficulties. Deep into the night, he would continue his studies, and even in his dreams problems would pursue him and work out their solution. 40 times, it is said, he read through the metaphysics of Aristotle, till the words were imprinted on his memory, but their meaning was hopelessly obscure, until one day they found illumination. From the little commentary by Farabi, which he bought at a bookstall for the small sum of 3 dirhams. So great was his joy at the discovery, made with the help of a work from which he had expected only mystery, that he hastened to return thanks to God, and bestowed alms upon the poor. He turned to medicine at 16, and not only learned medical theory, but also by gratuitous attendance of the sick had, according to his own account, discovered new methods of treatment. The teenager achieved full status as a qualified physician at age 18, and found that medicine is no hard and thorny science, like mathematics and metaphysics, so I soon made great progress. I became an excellent doctor and began to treat patients, using approved remedies. The youthful physician's fame spread quickly, and he treated many patients without asking for payment. Ibn Sina's first appointment was that of physician to the at face value. Avicenna was born c. 980 in Afsna, a village near Bukhara, in present-day Uzbekistan, the capital of the Samanids, a Persian dynasty in Central Asia and Greater Khorasan. His mother, named Sita, was from Bukhara. His father, Abdullah, was a respected Ismaili scholar from Balkh, an important town of the Samanid Empire, in what is today Balkh province, Afghanistan. His father was at the time of his son's birth the governor in one of the Samanid New Ibn Mansur's estates. He had his son very carefully educated at Bukhara. Ibn Sina's independent thought was served by an extraordinary intelligence and memory, which allowed him to overtake his teachers at the age of 14. As he said in his autobiography, there was nothing that he had not learned when he reached 18. A number of different theories have been proposed regarding Avicenna's madhab. Medieval historian Zahir al-Din al-Bayhaqi, d. 1169, considered Avicenna to be a follower of the Brethren of Purity. On the other hand, Dimitri Gittes, along with Aisha Khan and Jules J. Janssens, demonstrated that Avicenna was a Sunni Hanafi. However, Shia Faqih Nurullah Shastari and Syed Hossein Nasr, in addition to Henry Corbin, have maintained that he was most likely a 12 Shia. Similar disagreements exist on the background of Avicenna's family, whereas some writers considered them Sunni, more recent writers thought they were Shia. According to his autobiography, Avicenna had memorized the entire Quran by the age of 10. He learned Indian arithmetic from an Indian greengrocer, and he began to learn more from a wandering scholar who gained a livelihood by curing the sick. And Temir, new too, who owed him his recovery from a dangerous illness, 997. Ibn Sina's chief reward for this service was access to the royal library of the Samanids, well-known patrons of scholarship and scholars. When the library was destroyed by fire not long after, the enemies of Ibn Sina accused him of burning it, in order forever to conceal the sources of his knowledge. Meanwhile, he assisted his father in his financial labors, but still found time to write some of his earliest works. When Ibn Sina was 22 years old, he lost his father. The Samanid dynasty came to its end in December 1004. Ibn Sina seems to have declined the offers of Muhammad of Ghazni, and proceeded westwards to Urgench in modern Turkmenistan, where the vizier, regarded as a friend of scholars, gave him a small monthly stipend. The pay was small, however, so Ibn Sina wandered from place to place through the districts of Nishapur and Merv to the borders of Khorasan, seeking an opening for his talents. Qabus, the generous ruler of Tabaristan, himself a poet and a scholar, with whom Ibn Sina had expected to find asylum, was on about that date, 1012, starved to death by his troops who had revolted. Ibn Sina himself was at this time stricken by a severe illness. Finally, at Gorgan, near the Caspian Sea, Ibn Sina met with a friend, who bought a dwelling near his own house in which Ibn Sina lectured on logic and astronomy. Several of Ibn Sina's treatises were written for this patron, and the commencement of his Canon of Medicine also dates from his stay in Hyrcania. Ibn Sina subsequently settled at Ray, in the vicinity of modern Tehran, the hometown of Razis, where Majd ad-Dastan, part of Persia and Iraq, provided a thriving atmosphere for scholarly and cultural development. Under the Samanids, Bukhara rivaled Baghdad as a cultural capital of the Islamic world. The study of the Quran and the Hadith thrived in such a scholarly atmosphere. Philosophy, fiqh and theology, kalam, were further developed, most noticeably by Avicenna and his opponents. Al-Razi and Al-Farabi had provided methodology and knowledge in medicine and philosophy. Avicenna had access to the great libraries of Bork, Qa'izm, Gorgan, Ray, Isfahan and Hamadan. Various texts, such as the Ard with Bamaniyar, show that he debated philosophical points with the greatest scholars of the time. Aruzi Samarkandi describes how before Avicenna left Qa'izm he had met Rayhan Biruni, a famous scientist and astronomer, Abu Nasr Iraqi, a renowned mathematician, Abu Salmasihi, a respected philosopher, and Abu al-Kaykama, a great physician. Biography. Early life. The only source of information for the first part of Avicenna's life is his autobiography, as written down by his student Juzjani. In the absence of any other sources, it is impossible to be certain how much of the autobiography is accurate. It has been noted that he uses his autobiography to advance his theory of knowledge, that it was possible for an individual to acquire knowledge and understand the Aristotelian philosophical sciences without a teacher, and it has been questioned whether the order of events described was adjusted to fit more closely with the Aristotelian model. In other words, whether Avicenna described himself as studying things in the correct order. However, given the absence of any other evidence, Avicenna's account essentially has to be taken. Avicenna, Persian, c. 980, June 1037, is the Latinate form of Ibn Sina, Arabic, full name Abu Ali al-Husayn ibn Abdallah ibn al-Husayn ibn Ali ibn Sina. He was a Persian polymath regarded both in Europe and the Middle East as one of the most significant thinkers and writers of the Islamic Golden Age. He is known to have written around 450 works across a wide range of subjects, of which around 240 have survived, including 150 on philosophy and 40 on medicine. His most famous works are the Book of Healing, a vast philosophical and scientific encyclopedia, and the Canon of Medicine, an overview of all aspects of medicine that became a standard medical text at many medieval universities and remained in use as late as 1650, as well as philosophy and medicine. Avicenna's corpus also includes writings on astronomy, alchemy, geography and geology, psychology, Islamic theology, logic, mathematics, physics and poetry. Avicenna created an extensive corpus of works during what is commonly known as the Islamic Golden Age, in which the translations of Greco-Roman, Persian, and Indian texts were studied extensively. Greco-Roman, Mid and Neoplatonic, and Aristotelian texts by the Kindi school were commented, redacted and developed substantially by Islamic intellectuals, who also built upon Persian and Indian mathematical systems, astronomy, algebra, trigonometry and medicine. The Samanid dynasty in the eastern part of Persia, Greater Khorasan and Central Asia, as well as the Buyid dynasty in the west.